In this video, we're going to talk about energy and temperature. So, first of all, you probably have seen this before, I'm sure, but we classify two basic types of energy, kinetic and potential energy. And roughly, kinetic energy is energy associated with motion. Potential energy comes from the relative positions of two particles, two things. So, kinetic energy associated with motion. If you're anything that has mass and is moving has kinetic energy. Now, something can have potential energy, but not kinetic energy. For example, if I hold a pen above the floor and before I drop it, it has some potential energy due to due to gravity, right? The earth and the pen are acting on each other. And then when I drop that pen now and it starts moving, now it has kinetic energy. And here's the thing. You can convert kinetic energy to potential energy and vice versa. And this is how we do a lot of work, you know, how we drive a car, for example. So there's an equation, a pretty simple equation, that describes kinetic energy. KE stands for kinetic energy. And kinetic energy of any object is just 1/2 times the mass of that object in kilograms times its velocity squared. Velocity is in meters per second. So let's say you're running around a track and you have a certain velocity, a certain mass, of course, because whatever you weigh, that's what you weigh. And that means you have a certain kinetic energy. And you could calculate it if you knew your mass in kilograms and your velocity in meters per second. Now let's say you speed up. Because you have the same mass but a higher velocity, now you have more kinetic energy. All right. Now, energy has different units, and these are the units of energy that we will typically use. Mostly just the first and the last. Calories. Notice the capitalization is important here. Capital C is different than lowercase c. The second unit of energy, big calories, with a capital C. That's different than little calories here. This big calories, that's what we call, well, nutritional calories is another way of saying it. I'll tell you about that in a second. And joules. So you should know the names and the symbols. And now this is important. You need to know how to convert between different units of energy. And the top one here is kind of the key to all this. One calorie is equal to 4.184 joules. All of these conversions, by the way, you guys, are exact, meaning an infinite number of sig figs. They will not limit your significant figures in a calculation. So remember, one calorie is equal to 4.184 joules exactly. A big calorie, or a nutritional calorie, is exactly 1,000 little calories, which is the same as a kilocalorie. Remember, this, the prefix K stands for kilo, and that means times 10 to the third, right, or 1,000. So those are exact. And of course, one kilojoule is 1,000 joules, because kilo means 1,000, or times 10 to the third. So memorize these guys. We're going to use them. For example, if we needed to convert 7.23 calories to kilojoules, this would be a dimensional analysis problem, right? And so if you remember back to that, the first thing you want to find when you're reading a problem and using a dimensional analysis is the units of the answer. Well, we want to find kilojoules, so that's the unit of our answer. So we put a blank in kilojoules. Now, the second thing you find, right, is the starting point. What do we want to convert into kilojoules? 7.23 calories. And so you write an equal sign, and then you write your starting point next to it. And then you look for conversion factors. Well, here, conversion factors aren't given to you in the problem because I'm asking you to memorize them. So one calorie is equal to 4.184 joules, and one kilojoule is 1,000 joules. And remember, what you do is you just start with the units here, look for something that you know about it. Well, you know that one calorie is 4.184 joules. That's pretty much what you know about them so far. Make sure the units cancel algebraically, so calories and calories cancels. And at that point we have joules, and then you look for joules, put it on the bottom, kilojoules goes on top, and our answer is 0.0302 sub 5 kilojoules. Why 3 sig figs? Because this guy here has 3 sig figs, and well, remember, all of these are exact. So we end up with 0.0303 kilojoules. Now, heat and thermal energy, some definitions. When we talk about thermal energy, what we mean is the total kinetic energy of the particles in a system. Heat is a process by which thermal energy is transferred. Now let's pause for a minute and think about this. Most people, and actually to be honest with you, most chemistry textbooks, they use the word heat when they really mean thermal energy. That's okay, but I'm telling you what it really means here. And anything you have, let's imagine you have a bottle of water right in front of you, okay? Now, even though you can't see it, if you could see the individual atoms and molecules of water in there, you would see that they're moving around constantly all the time. If you could see the molecules and the atoms in the air that you're breathing right here, you would see that they're constantly in motion, moving around. And remember, anything that has mass and is moving has kinetic energy. And so those particles have some kinetic energy. Now, heat is the process by which we transfer this thermal energy. You know, if you take something hot and something cold and you put them together, let them touch, well, the hot thing gets cooler and the cool thing gets warmer, right? The reason for that is this thermal energy, this kinetic energy, is transferred from the hot thing into the cold thing. Kind of like pool balls, really. The hot thing's moving faster, and when those atoms, the molecules of the hot thing, hit the colder thing, some of that energy gets transferred, and now the particles that were cold start moving faster, so they have more thermal energy, and they heat up, we say. Now, to get the idea of what heat is, you can think about rain. Now, rain is the process by which rain, water, is transferred from clouds to the earth. You can't collect rain. You can collect rain water, but rain is the process, where just like heat's the process by which this thermal energy is transferred. Now, temperature. Temperature is how we measure thermal energy. And the hot, we say hotter and colder. The hotter something is, the higher its temperature, the higher its thermal energy, which means kinetic energy, right? And what that means is that the hotter something is, the faster the particles, the atoms and molecules in that thing are moving. And the colder something is, the slower they're moving. We're gonna use this concept several times throughout the semester. So now, different units of temperature. The three units of temperature we will use in this course are Fahrenheit, Celsius, and Kelvin. These equations give you the relationships between the three. T sub F stands for temperature in Fahrenheit. T sub C stands for temperature in Celsius. And if you know the temperature in Celsius, you multiply it by 1.8 and then add 32. Now, write this down. The 32 and the 1.8 are exact, so they do not affect your sig figs. If you know the temperature in Fahrenheit, you subtract 32 exactly from it, then divide by 1.8 to give you the temperature in degrees Celsius. And if you know the temperature in Celsius, just add 273.15 to it to get the temperature in Kelvin. The 273.15 is also exact. So memorize these conversions. Let's use them. Now, this picture here is really good, I think, because it illustrates where those equations that we just saw come from. So the idea is this gives you the freezing point of water down here and the boiling point of water on these three different scales, Kelvin, Celsius, and Fahrenheit. So let's look at the relationship between Kelvin and Celsius. Well, water freezes at about 273, actually it's 273.15 Kelvin, and it boils at 373 Kelvin. So the difference in the freezing point and the boiling point of water in Kelvins is 100. Oh, real quick, a small point. We say degrees Celsius and degrees Fahrenheit, but we don't say degrees Kelvin, we just say Kelvins. Now, the difference between the freezing point of water and degrees Celsius, which is 0 degrees Celsius, and the boiling point of water, which is 100 degrees Celsius, is also 100 degrees Celsius. So there are 100 degrees Celsius on the same region where there are 100 Kelvins. And so the size of a degree Celsius is exactly the same as the size of the Kelvin. The only difference between these two scales is they're shifted by actually 273.15. So all we have to do to convert the temperature in degrees Celsius to Kelvins is add 273.15 from it. That's where we got this equation right down here. Now, looking at the relationship between Celsius and Fahrenheit, it's a little more complicated because two things are going on. First of all, the difference in the freezing point of water and the boiling point of water in Fahrenheit, degrees Fahrenheit, which is 32 freezing, 212 boiling, is 180, exactly 180 degrees Fahrenheit. Whereas there's only 100 degrees Celsius over the same region, which means there are more degrees Fahrenheit over the same region than there are degrees Celsius. Matter of fact, there are 180 over 100, or 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit per every 1 degree Celsius. And we also have the freezing point shifted, everything shifted by 32 Fahrenheit. So if we go back and look at the relationship between Celsius and Fahrenheit, degrees Celsius, degree Fahrenheit, we have to multiply by the 1.8 here, multiply the temperature in degrees Celsius by 1.8, because there are more degrees Fahrenheit than there are degrees Celsius in the same region, 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit for every 1 degree Celsius. And we have to shift it by 32, that's this here. And this equation here, it's just this one rearranged algebraically. So that's that. Now let's do an example. Let's say we know the temperature in degrees Fahrenheit and we want to convert to both degrees Celsius and Kelvins. Now real quick, this is not really a dimensional analysis problem. It's the other type of problem that you'll see commonly in chemistry, and that is one where you have a formula and all you have to do is plug in. So that's all we're going to do, is we're going to plug in. We're going to plug into the formula, go back and check and see where I got this from. This is the relationship where if you know the temperature in Fahrenheit, you want to find the temperature in Celsius. So the temperature in Fahrenheit, which we're given, minus 32 over 1.8. And notice the units here, Fahrenheit minus 32 Fahrenheit over, this is 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit per 1 degree Celsius. When we do the subtraction, because the 32 is exact, this is not, we keep one place to the right of the decimal, make sure you know why that is, which is 37.2. Then when we divide, the 1.8 is exact, the 37.2 has 3 sig figs, so we get keep 3 sig figs, which is 20.6. And then the first insignificant figure is a 6 degrees Celsius. Rounding, we get the temperature in degrees Celsius. Now, pay attention to this, because this is a real common mistake. Now we're going to find the temperature in Kelvin. Notice I did not use the 20.7 degrees Celsius here, but rather I used my unrounded number. And actually what I did is and you should do these calculations yourself, you'll find that there are more 6s after this in your calculator. Use everything that you get for this number in your calculator here. And then when you add 273.15 to it, this 273.15 is exact. We get 293.8, and the first insignificant figure is 1. We keep one place to the right of the decimal because we're adding. This has 1 to the right. This is exact. Now, if you use the 20.7, you'd get 273.85, which rounds to 273.9. You get a different number. So make sure you don't do that. Anyway, we round to 293.8. 293.8.